Melinda presents this unabridged recording of Land of Golden Wattle, written by J.H. Fletcher and read by Jennifer Vuletic. The dedication reads, "To my parents." The glory of the wattle enshrines every creek with gold. Traditional. Society is a partnership between the living, the dead, and those who are still to be born. Edmund Burke. I hold past and future in my hands. Bec Hampton. This book depicts attitudes and ways of speech, particularly in regard to Australian Indigenous people, which were sometimes used during the period it covers. In reproducing this book, neither the publisher nor the narrator endorse the attitudes or opinions expressed. It was 11 o'clock in the morning and a kookaburra was calling from one of the stringybark trees as Rebecca, all her life known as Bec to everyone but her late grandmother-in-law Bessie Penrose, stepped onto Derwent's wooden deck. The big house, surrounded by its vast acreage, had been her home for 68 years. It stood on the summit of the sharp-sided hill that for 1.5 centuries had been called Emma's Lookout, and from its north-facing deck you could see forever. Granddaughter Tamara was standing with her hands on the guardrail and Bec joined her. Side by side they looked out beyond the rock-strewn hillside and the undulating paddocks flowing down the long valley to the heat-shimmered line of distant hills. All this was Derwent land, bright with golden wattle in spring but now burnt brown by the summer sun. Emma Dark had named the estate in 1831, and now Derwent was the largest property in the Tasmanian high country. Bec could feel the sun burning holes in the top of her head. "Looks like we got another scorcher, and me all done up like a pox doctor's clerk." Nothing to be done about that, because today, Saturday, the 13th of February, was a special occasion, or so everyone but Bec seemed to think. As far as she was concerned, it was a load of nonsense. She wasn't slow to say so either. She said it now. "A lot of fuss about nothing," said Bec. Tamara sighed. "It's your 85th birthday. You think that's nothing?" "It's only important if you reckon it's the last one I'll be having," Bec said. "Otherwise, it's a day like any other. Nothing to make a fuss about." It was a lot worse than a fuss. Bec thought chaos would have been a better word, with caterers and the florist and a regiment of women who had been brought in to set out the tables and cook the food and light the barbecue and organise the drinks and arrange the flowers and put out the birthday cards and... "The good Lord give me strength," Bec said. "I guess he will," Tamara said. "He's done pretty well by you so far." Bec supposed that was true, but was not about to admit it. With age, she suspected she was getting to be more and more like her old nemesis, Grandma Bessie. These days, it seemed more fun to grouse than smile. Grousing kept the competition on its toes, and by the time people got to her age, just about everyone was competition, being younger and therefore likely to outlive her if she didn't watch it. "A 100th might be worth a nod," she said. "That would be something. Isn't that what they say? Not many people die above 100. 85 is neither here nor there. You're old, even if you feel as fit as a flea, but that doesn't mean you like having it thrust down your throat. That's the only purpose I can see of having this party, to remind me I'm old. Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I'm not planning to keel over just yet." "I should hope not," Tamara said. "I've gone to a lot of trouble to get this blowout sorted. Don't you go dropping dead on me. Spoil the mood, would it?" "I wouldn't say that, but it would be bloody inconvenient having people tripping over your body all the time." Bec laughed. "There's some would say I've been an inconvenience all my life." "And proud of it," said Tamara. That was what Bec liked about her granddaughter. Tamara had spirit. She was a fighter, and Bec, who'd been a fighter all her life, valued that quality above all others. Tamara was proof that the blood was still strong. Ever since the days of Emma Tregellas, the first member of the family to set foot on the island, the women had shown them. Yet today there was something in her granddaughter's manner that seemed somehow different from usual. "You okay?" she asked. "Why shouldn't I be?"
"Just asking."
There was something. Bec was convinced of it. 2 days before, at Beck's suggestion, Tamara had gone to the new Agfest show. It was an hour's drive away, and Bec had assumed she'd be back that evening, but in the event, she wasn't. She hadn't said what she'd been up to, and Bec hadn't asked, but judging by the way she'd been since she got back, it was obvious that something had happened. Bec wasn't going to push it. She'd find out soon enough if there were anything to find out. Now she looked at the cloudless sky, with the sun promising to be even more of a torment by mid-afternoon. "A birthday bash is always a good excuse for a piss-up," Tamara said.
"This mob doesn't need an excuse," Bec said. "When are they arriving anyway?"
"The first of them should be turning up in about half an hour."
"Trotters in the trough," Bec said. "I can't wait."
"Be nice," Tamara said. "They're only coming because they love you." Bec cackled like a pregnant chook.
"They're coming to feed their faces and to try and find out whether your dad will let you go on running Derwent when he packs in being a trustee, or whether he plans to appoint somebody else."
"We'd all like to know that," Tamara said.
"I doubt you need worry," Bec said. "With David gone, there's nobody but you."
She could say it now. When they'd had the news that Tamara's brother had been killed in Milan 2 years before, the shock of her grandson's death had left Bec so traumatised that she had been barely able to speak. She'd hauled herself out of the shadows eventually, as she had so often in her life, but talking about it would never be easy. The pain would remain, but life moved on, and you had to move with it and pretend all was well. "I hope you're right," Tamara said. "Derwent's my life. You know that. But Dad's always been against having a woman in charge."
"He got that idea from Bessie Penrose. Her father had set up the trust, but Bessie was determined to use it to make sure I would never get my hands on it." "You're running it now in any case," Bec said.
"But I'm not a trustee."
"Of course not. The man's still alive, isn't he?"
"As far as we know. When was the last time you spoke to him?"
"On his birthday, 20th of June.
Nearly 8 months before." "Anything could have happened to him in that time," Tamara said.
"He's still cashing his checks."
As trustee under the family trust, Giles, Bec's only son and Tamara's father, was custodian not merely of the Derwent land, but of its pride and history. But he'd never given a toss about any of that. There had been hard words about what Bec had called his selfishness, but Giles couldn't have cared less what his mother thought or said. First, his wife Kathleen had walked out on him. Then, on Tamara's 18th birthday, he had split too, heading to Sydney like a latter-day Paul Gauguin to play at being an artist. Unfortunately, he didn't have Gauguin's talent, but that hadn't affected his lifestyle. As trustee and principal beneficiary, he treated Derwent as a cash cow. The payouts he got as beneficiary allowed him to pursue his only real talent, playing games with a succession of bimbos whom he managed God knew how to entice into his bed. Bec had protested, but it had done no good.
"Stop your nagging, Ma," Giles had said. "I could always sell it, you know." "It's not yours to sell. It belongs to the trust. And as trustee, I can realise whatever assets I like."
To Bec, that had been the ultimate sacrilege.
"You would get rid of Derwent. Sell your heritage?"
Giles had sneered.
"What's my heritage ever done for me? I'll tell you something, Ma. The only reason I don't sell it is because of David. I know what the place means to him. But don't keep on at me, okay? Or I might change my mind."
So Bec had said no more. She would never admit it even to herself, but Giles had been a sad disappointment to her. And now David was dead.
"Is your dad coming today?" she asked.
"No idea. We sent him an invite, but he didn't answer."
Well, ain't that a surprise, Bec said.
I better go and make sure they've got everything ready for our guests, Tamara said.
Mustn't keep the hogs waiting, Bec said.
She watched Tamara walk into the house. Thank God for her, she thought. Tamara represented the future of the family and, surely, of Derwent itself. But Bec remained uneasy, never able to forget how their lives and future were hostage to her son's whims. 150 years before, Emma and her husband had built the house on land granted to them by Lieutenant Governor Arthur. 20,000 acres in the middle of what at the time had been a dangerous wilderness, and imported merino sheep from Spain. The genes of those first animals still existed in the abundant flocks that over the years had made Derwent the huge operation it now was. Bec looked out across the upland paddocks with their grazing flocks, the watered valleys rich with canola, triticale, and poppies. The initial holding had grown first to 30,000 acres on the death of Emma's uncle Barnsley, and then to 50,000 acres after Emma's granddaughter Bessie had snared Phelan Penrose into marriage 111 years before. At least that was something she did, Bec thought. The old bitch.
Laid herself out like a plate of meat,
Bec remembered telling Tamara only last week.
You can be sure of that.
She was the only member of the family old enough to remember Bessie and the antagonism that had inspired unremitting war between them until the moment of Bessie's death.
He would have lived to regret it, she said. You can bet your socks on that. Bessie would have made for tough chewing. Too tough for little Phelan, that's for sure.
Below the house, stringy barks towered as proud as guardsmen above the tangled scrub. Bec's husband, Jonathan, had had them planted in March 1914 to celebrate their marriage. In those days, the roads of the high country had been gravel tracks where in winter the horses' hooves struck sparks from the frozen ground. But the road joining the house to the Midlands Highway had been sealed in the early 1970s after Bec, still fancying her Grand Prix chances at 75, had nearly done a high dive off what she had thereafter named Nitwit Corner, the hairpin halfway up the hill where the road skirted the edge of a 100-foot drop. Born lucky, Bec thought, or at least so far. There had been tragedies along the way, but on the whole, the family hadn't done too badly since Emma Tregellas arrived in what then had been called Van Diemen's Land. The living and the dead, Bec had often said, all of them both past and future. Now, with advancing age, her thoughts turned more and more to Tamara, because in Tamara, Emma and the rest lived, as they did in her. The family's history was a tale of gold, wool, and a lust for land, of enmity and love, blood and fulfillment, and a scandal that Bessie at least had been determined to conceal. She existed in their image. The past and future, both were now. She could see their faces, hear their voices, share their rain and sun and wind. Emma, living three lifetimes in her own short life, had been the first. 1826. When Major Toby Tregellas, her belligerent father, was killed in a duel, 17-year-old Emma went to Norfolk to live with her bachelor guardian, the Reverend Arthur Naismith. She didn't want to go. She disliked Arthur and his pious ways. She disliked his clammy hands and his eyes, sly and pale, which undressed her when he thought she wasn't looking. She disliked the way he listed all the things a young lady was not permitted to do. She must not run. She must not sing except in church. She must not raise her voice. She must not walk unescorted. She must be obedient, quiet, and respectful at all times, especially to Arthur and Arthur's patroness, the elderly and autocratic Dowager Countess of Redwald, whose residence, Redwald Hall, lay a mile from the Norfolk coast. Emma liked nothing about him at all. "He wants me to be a mouse," she told her reflection. "I am not a mouse." Nor had any intention of becoming one. At Chatham Barracks, where her father had been stationed before his fatal duel, the Major had treated her with more than usual indulgence. As a companion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.